Good afternoon and welcome to this webinar on Indian diagnostics on roller coaster. I don't know why diagnostic, all complete healthcare is on the roller coaster. In fact, the COVID, I think only one good point I think I can draw from the COVID, that it has taught us, it has exposed where we really lack. I was looking at the news channel yesterday that 80% of the patients in Karnataka are going to the private sector for COVID treatment. In fact, I being the convener of the COVID task force from the industry side, we had recommended that the pandemic has to be dealt with by the government first, followed up by public sector, defense, railways, and then only if there's a shortfall in capacity, the private sector will pitch in. But I think over the period, we are finding, even in Delhi, for example, 11,600 beds are with the Delhi government. But over and above, recently, Delhi government has issued an order that private sector should keep 80% ICU bed reserved for COVID. We really do not know where have we gone wrong. And that has really brought down our requirement in our healthcare. We are drastically short. And that's where I was looking at the survey by WHO, where they have rated India as 112 rank out of 191. Bangladesh is above us, Sri Lanka is much above us, and all this is happening because of the factors that we have shortage of availability. Accessibility is a very serious factor. And over and above, the WHO has also shown that we are very poor in regulating the sector. The healthcare has to be regulated, in that there is no doubt. But somehow I think regulation has been very irrational. And the diagnostic is the first part of the healthcare. Actually, many times, because I have evolved, the quality assurance in this country, particularly NABH, and NABL also has been very, initial part, I have been very strongly connected. I used to say that diagnostic is the mother of the healthcare quality. The quality starts from the diagnostic. And I was looking at, I keep working with the Planning Commission those days. They used to tell us, and even today, that we find in radiology, for example, 11,000 radiologists are in the entire country. And you can understand what kind of scenario we have. Similarly, in the laboratory side also, if we remove biochemist, MSc and PhD biochemist, and MSc and PhD in microbiology, we will again fall drastically short because we have very few MD pathology. Similarly, the laboratories are also crowded in the class A city, tier 1, tier 2 cities, while in tier 3 city, we do not have the accessibility to the diagnostic. So, point is, if we are being told by the WHO that you need 2.5 times the beds as compared to today, accordingly, the diagnostic also has to go up in that direction. But over and above, the regulation, quality, market is bringing up the condition where the financial sustainability is becoming a big issue. I think that, unfortunately, has not been realized by the government. I am saying so. And I think sooner we understand this economics equation, that if you need quality, if you need patient safety, it is going to cost. And that, I think, equation has to be understood both by private and government. So I think today's talk, we will be focusing only on the diagnostic, not much on the hospital side. And we have, of course, the four very prominent, I must, commend on the selection of the panel, that very experienced and at the same time young people have been brought in to this webinar. And their introduction has already been shared with the viewers. So the time being 1:55 being the closing time, I think that puts us the military, we come under the military rule, that you can't extend. And but there, hopefully, there will be a lot of good discussion required on this subject. So without, I think, adding any more, I'll reserve my some comments at the end if the time permits. So I'll start with our first panelist, Thomas John. I think he is a key figure because Agape is the one of the leading IVF manufacturer in our country. And so I think we look forward, and as I communicated, we will have 7 minutes each. Either you make presentation through PPT, some of you are already making, as I know. Otherwise, you put up your points extempore. So, are you ready, Thomas John?
I'm ready.
Please.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Doctor. Yeah, thank you, Dr. Gani, for good introduction. First of all, I'm Thomas John. I'm Managing Director of Agape Diagnostics Limited. We are a 25-year-old company, present in the IVD space in India, and we export to about 55 countries. First of all, let me thanks to, the organizers of the today's program, that Global Healthcare Unity Summit. So I have three or four slide presentations. Directly, I will come to the presentations. See, the major changes, which according to me, in the IVD, in vitro diagnostics lab space, which I've seen that there are a lot of restrictions on the movement of elderly people, has reduced the direct work in patients for standalone laboratories. That has created a drop in the estimations like diabetic profile and lipid profile. And same time, in the health checkup package also, almost totally stopped or very minimal in the corporate hospital and laboratory because of the restriction in the movement. And a lot of surgeries, especially in this summer vacation time, is postponed, and dental procedures also, it's reduced. So laboratories in the rural area where we present more in that areas was forced to lock down because of staff shortage and restrictions in the movement. As per the study, we expect that about 200 to 800 crores deficit or drop in the business in the initial period of this industry. And the visitors and patients in the hospital is dropped about 70 to 80%. I'm more talk about the industry where I have little more knowledge. The IVD segment is, on the contrary, it is really growing and showing very good growth amidst the other economic segment. Huge market demand in the pandemic for COVID-19 test, especially in the PCR and the products which are coming in the rapid test for the COVID detection. Then there is a big demand of and a segment called nucleic acid extraction reagent and equipment. And we are quite strong in the COVID prognostic segments, where the specific protein estimations, D-dimer, ferritin, CRP, PCT, etc. The business has gone like anything. So there is a very good growth, and even the hematology segment also, we have observed a good growth. Industry witnessed an exponential rise in the Indianized manufacturers, especially in the molecular diagnostics products and other prognosis products like a specific protein segment. Product diversification by local manufacturers, because we started manufacturing thermal scanners, then sanitizers, etc. About 3 to 4 companies backed a business of about 2,500 crores business in the molecular diagnostics till September. Finally, there is an increased awareness and importance of lab diagnostics in India. As a result, till the last year, the Indian IVD was contributing about less than 1% of the global IVD, where about 1.35 billion people are living, which is about 17.5% of the global population. But because of the COVID, the Indian share of global IBD is expected to jump to about 3% by FY21. And because of the influence of COVID-19, we have observed that there is a shrinkage of clinical chemistry, because earlier it was about 26% to 18%, and even immunology also 36 to 28%. But molecular diagnostics, 4% to about 26%, which is very, very high. So now this technology is really driving because of the COVID scenario. And by end of FY21, the overall business of COVID is approximately about 12,500 crores. And in Agape, we focus more on the prognosis of COVID, and we are one of the leaders of the prognosis products like D-dimer, CRP, ferritin. We manage about 70% of this business through our dedicated protein systems. And we have sold about 3 million tests of CRP and 1 million tests of D-dimer, and about 0.3 million tests of ferritin. So we are very much focused on the hematology also. Recently we have launched the first Indianized hematology analyzers called MISPA Countex. So Agape, we have understood, I think even other industrial partners also, you know, will accept or will recognize this. You know, this is the time for local manufacturing. This is the time for thinking about bringing a lot of technologies within India so that our Indian populations can get the benefit. So we are definitely focused to that. And we wanted to address this by lot of local partnership with the industry bodies as well as the technical institutions. Now we are planning to bring the lab-based COVID testing, which are in the process. Maybe within 2 weeks' time, we will be able to bring that. And there are a lot of many COVID-related products, like we are also planning to come with an antigen-based testing device for the COVID. So I am very clear that we wanted to represent the COVID scenario in a better way, where we can bring a lot of domestic products. So as the industrial partner, I think all the industrial friends or colleagues are focused on this. And I'm sure that this will give the advantage and benefits to the Indian populations. With this, I conclude. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think you have covered the entire thing in the stipulated time. And now I turn to my another young colleague, Dr. Arjun Dam. Let me get into the pathology now. Now, Dan Laboratory, actually I have been personally following for ages now. I think this lab established and created a niche market for itself, you know, because, Naveen, you know, has been a man, you know, who actually B.C. Roy awardee, and is known for, you know, the ethics and quality right from the beginning, which is was not easy, you know. I used to see that this was the one lab in the north and another Roy and Trivedi lab used to be in the Calcutta. You know, they had that different kind of approach. So Arjun has to really come up, I will say, to fit into the shoes of Naveen, you know, the kind of impact which he has created. So I think Arjun is going to really tell us the challenges how the Indian diagnostic is facing. So I invite Dr. Arjun to please present your slides, or are you going to speak?
Hi, a very, very good morning to everyone here. And it's a pleasure and an absolute privilege to be a part of this panel. So what COVID-19 actually made happen that no one could actually see coming? And I'm sure it was actually a roller coaster for most of the diagnostic firms here. But here at Dang's Lab, what we actually saw and experienced was that there was a phenomenal apprehension in patients in actually visiting any healthcare facility. And since we are largely a walk-in based lab, we had a lot of patients who liked or who wanted to switch to having tests done at home itself. Now, amidst the COVID pandemic, not only training our staff in a very robust manner regarding the infection control protocols, but also making an extremely seamless, paperless, online platform that is digital for the patients not only to book their testing but also to access results was the need of the hour. And I'm happy to say that we effectively have managed to do that. Apart from that, also what we had to embrace was medtech and introducing new technologies, new platforms to ultimately give a seamless experience to all our patients who actually wanted to get their tests done from home. Apart from this, also COVID has again taught us that patients are getting increasingly aware about health-related issues. Their knowledge is much more that was there in the past few years, and they actually recognize quality, and they also recognize that a lab test report is not just some values on a piece of paper, but it does dictate a majority of the management decision that the doctors enforce. Apart from this, also what COVID actually stressed upon the most was how to train everyone, starting from the most basic housekeeping staff who are senior most doctors, about infection control protocols, not only while interacting with patients, but also interacting among the staff in the company as well.
Okay. Thank you very much. And I will be raising few questions on you later on. And then I will go to my another very young, enterprising colleague, Mr. Rawal. Mr. Rawal is actually the managing director of the company MyLab Discovery Solutions. He is postgraduate in medical biotechnology and started his professional career working with Invitrogen. He was responsible for business development for high-end equipment like sequencer, real-time PCR from Applied Biosystems across Western India. And I can see he also has worked in the BD, which is a very leading international company, and we help them in boosting their market. So I think he is another kind of different, you know, breed actually coming in front of us to speak on the subject today, Indian diagnostic on the roller coaster. And I think we look forward for what solution he is going to provide to us. Over to Hasmukh Rawal.
Sure, sir. First of all, thank you, all the presenters as well as the organizer for arranging us. It is a privilege to talk to all the guys who have been leading this segment at different areas over this. I'll just share my screen.
Yes.
So, of course, COVID has been catalyst and a roller coaster. The journey has been a roller coaster over the last. So diagnostic before COVID was a very different domain when it is about awareness of masses, using of tests to the different labs. Till date, we have been using traditional ways only to look at the disease, but while a high-end test was not readily available, just to give you an idea, after like Mr. Amitabh Bachchan himself got infected with blood which was not tested correctly, so many people getting HIV, HIV through bloods and they've been waiting, relying much on the serological test, while a major aspect like high-end testing molecular was highly ignored. Of course, there were many challenges like price, availability, awareness, and that is where we have been lacking. So, diagnostic before COVID, where molecular diagnostic, as I said, was very costly, limited, and inaccessible. very few laboratory could do such kind of tests. They were costly and they were very limited portfolio of testing solution around it. Awareness was also very less. Even the common man, they didn't know when they approached the labs which kind of tests are right or wrong or recommendable at different areas of prognosis. Media also have hardly reported or talked ever in terms of sensitivity or specificity of such testing solution. What I see is last 6 months have been a roller coaster where we could achieve what a country would have taken otherwise 60 years to ramp up to this level. If you see today, we have more than 1,500 plus labs. I think it is growing about 2,000 as we speak now, who are doing this kind of RT-PCR based test. Thousands of lab test technicians have already skilled themselves to do this kind of testing. They understand the processes, the trouble, what or the troubleshooting as well. The large installation base of infrastructure will remain once installed today for years of the time to come. Now it is very accessible. There are so many Indian companies who have come across. We have Thomas sir as well, who have also entered into this domain, looking at the opportunity to serve the masses when India needs most. So there are so many companies which have been so strong in other domains have also entered in this. We ourselves have been first to launch RT-PCR test, antigen test. We also launched a benchtop molecular platform, where the low investment, even at a rural area, you can do the test. Supply chain for molecular diagnostic solutions, be it a raw material, in process product, storage, handling, everything has been improved. What has happened is also the journalists, the media people have also spent hours to understand what kind of tests where to be used and why they should be recommended. They have made it very easy for the masses to understand. That's why you can the people could talks about this kind of different testing solution and their benefits. So what I see is, of course, COVID has been a catalyst for last 6 months to increase the speed of our diagnostic understanding by 60 years. But yeah, there are a lot many improvements which we see from here, and which over a period we will have to improve. And number one is we have to make sure that these high quality tests, along with the available portfolio of solution, should be available to the masses at a price. Maintaining the quality while we increasing the quantity is very important. Also, ecosystem for innovation should be there with the right incentives. A lot of small startups have come up with the good ideas. The sector will ripe for innovation, and we need to capitalize it. Also, solutions should be accessible to everyone. Innovation in terms of automation, like what we have done in terms of compact Excel, we reach masses. And we should make sure that even not only the Tier A or Tier B cities, but even the rural areas will get establishment to serve the testing solution for the masses. So that is where I believe there were early challenges we have converted into opportunities for the masses at a country level.
Thank you. We will have a little question. So what I will be doing now, Dr. Ravi Gaur, of course, you know, is one of the most experienced, you know, I know him for I don't know how many years. Because Dr. Ravi is a qualified onco pathologist by profession and 30 years of experience, more than 30 years of experience in the field of pathology and healthcare management. His core competence is pathology, molecular biology, immunology, personalized and precision medicine. These are the topics of the future, you know, which he is actually already working, and evolving technology. So he is a pioneer in the pathologist and has changed the trend in the pathology practice in India. In fact, he has been one of the very active person, let me tell you, on the all industrial platforms. And the question is that people who are so good in academics, sometimes they do not spend time on the industry issue. But he is the one man I found, he spends time to, you know, the raising concern about the industry at the same time about his academics. So I'm going to actually, instead of, you know, asking him to do the presentation, I will ask him straight away three questions, you know, which he will answer, you know. So first is that because you are also engaged in the overseas market. So Dr. Ravi, can you tell us, did you feel any problems in sample collection from the overseas? That is my first question. Or let me put all the three questions, then you can answer in your own way. The second question is, do you feel the need to redesign the strategy to sustain the diagnostic business? This, I think, the key question. I think all of us are really worried about it. And the last third question will be, how can technology, I think you are the one who can really tell us, how can technology, you know, help us in efficient and affordable diagnostics? So these are the three questions. One is sample collection from overseas. Second is redesigning the strategy to sustain the business of diagnostic. And third is, how will you suggest technology intervention to make the diagnostic affordable and efficient? Dr. Ravi.
Good afternoon, sir. And I think I'll say thank you so much for putting those kind words. And I think as I started with, it's basically I'm acquiring wisdom from people like you. And of course, I interact with youngsters like Hasmul Ali and Arjun. I learn from here and there, and probably I just replicate. Probably it's a combination of what I'm putting it across. Rightly said, the topic today, where the voice of health has said, Indian diagnostic rural cluster. I think this one second thing I like to put across. If you look at the diagnostics utility, probably they give this 70% or 80% of information is here from the clinical point of view given by diagnostic people. But the focus of the everything is probably lesser on diagnostics, hardly, because if you look at the innovations, developments, a lot of things are happening in diagnostic, but the current focus today is still on the illness, the treatment, the therapeutics, and probably after that, the prognostics. And this is where I think the COVID has seen us. We have, I think, started with roller coaster does it what? It takes you up. And today, the diagnostic, the first thing is test, and then track and treat. Not like treat, and then in something comes up, then test, and then probably that was the normal process which was being followed earlier. So we are definitely on the high side, and diagnostic today, and especially pathology diagnostic, and there's some radiology diagnostics too, for that matter, they are playing a very, very important role in controlling the pandemic and making understand the disease pattern, how it would behave, and what would the future. We still don't know because there's a lot many changes are happening on a day-to-day basis, or the COVID is presenting to, and patients are presenting. I come from Onquest, and Onquest has been one of the largest molecular oncology diagnostic provider in the country for last so many years. And that is where I think we started this utilizing molecular platform way back, right from 2004 and 5, and then for 2009 we scaled up, and today we are utilizing the molecular platform cross segment, not only oncology but for the infectious disease or even for lifestyle disorders or genomics for prediction and predisposition too. Now, once the question what you ask is like, you know, what has happened to the problems in sample collection? So I'll like to add to the audience here. COVID-19 has placed constraints on almost every aspect of any organization, healthcare organization to operate. Every aspect has been altered. Today, operations are full of complexity, uncertainty, and ambiguity. We really don't know how things are going to be. But then as a manager, as a healthcare provider, we really have to think way ahead and keep innovating, a lot of innovating processes and methodology to make sure that the services continue. Now, when you're talking about the sample transport overseas, I'll probably say what we are talking about overseas. I think during the COVID pandemic, it was difficult to even pick up a sample from the neighboring colony and to come into my lab. There was a challenges right from the, you know, within this city, the challenges from within the NCR, the borders were sealed, they were not allowing transfers, sample to be transported. And the best part, the staff, technology, though, they were scared. And there were a lot of guidelines, not like Government of India has some very, very good lines on ICMR, but very advisories were issued. But state health being a state subject, they had their own decision, and that led us to a lot of challenges in sample transportation. Now, how do they transport, the safety measures, biosafety measures, the temperatures, and how to maintain the quality of samples? That's where the challenges were there. Now, you're talking about overseas, we had challenges getting sample like from Nepal, Bangladesh, Malaysia, Sri Lanka, the borders were almost like no flight, nothing. How do we get a transport sample transported here? It was really next to impossible at during that phase. But in the, after about 2 months or so, things eased out and things became better. Now, here the question came for us, because I have been one of the oncology, because we, you just mentioned the start with COVID and non-COVID bits here. A lot of focus being oncology high-end testing. A lot of samples are being transported. Samples come from the South Asia to India, and from here they go abroad also for the testing. And this is where at least high-end oncology tests, which are done abroad, and if they can be right diagnosis and right direction given, probably in a, you know, zero stage or stage one, the treatment is beneficial. Because of the blockade of sample transportation, probably the decisions were delayed. And the stage to one patient at one time probably got, by the time they were able to take the test, they landed up into stage three. And that's what they suffer. I think the non-COVID patient did suffer a lot, are probably, especially the cancer patient, they're really facing the big challenge because of transport issue. Now, then this is, the second question you asked now was the lab to redesign. Yes, I think this is a time to rethink what we have been doing, the way we have been doing. Our businesses were probably, or the patients were not coming to the lab in month of April, May, June. It was almost routine testing was almost gone down by 70-80%. And we were all, patients were scared. We don't know, they were not able to come to the hospitals for a weekend, and nobody wanted to visit. Nobody wanted phlebotomists to come to their center, home for even collection. They were too scared. So we have to really reskill our people, as Arjun has mentioned, that revalidate our people, assure our patients and customers that the doctors, look, we are all safety trained, all precautions will be taken, all kind of a quality precautions will be taken. The staff will be monitored regularly on a regular basis so that they don't carry the disease back to your home. And then, next thing also we have to now think is the continuous spectrum, wellness and illness today. Because today the testing is more or less still on the 80-90% illness oriented. You develop a symptom, you come with a disease. But I think COVID has taught us like early diagnosis, a very early diagnosis, and a probably a correct diagnosis. So even the wellness, and you have to have a preventive health check. All these testing profiles have to be redesigned, rethought of. Because during the lockdown period, a lot of non-COVID patients, especially senior citizens or who had a comorbidity patient, they were not able to walk out. No exercise, no eating packed food, obesity with gone up, hormonal status, stress, anxiety, everything has changed. So I think all the profile packages, everything probably have to be redesigned and rethought of. And more pathologists, I will say that, really have to communicate more with their customer. They have to counsel them, talk to them, make them aware of like what diagnostics can offer. Like you, Thomas has mentioned about CRP. I think the way the CRP has given us, utilized now today, is an inflammatory marker. I think every, even simple infection, viral fever, any CRP is being used in a big way. So these are very, very simple tests, easy tests, but they have to be integrated into our practice. I think that has shown the results today. And is helping out a lot. So I think similarly for all NCDs, I think NCDs now has to be integrated together with your personal genomics. You know, what's your genomics? How's your lifestyle? How's your, what are your eating habit? How much time you're doing exercises? And where you come from? And so, or, and what are your biochemical parameters? Together now, I think the health checks, the preventive health checks will come up with a personalized score. Where, what is the risk of this disease, I think? This is where I think the change is going to happen, and it's going to be good for a good. Now, the last question you asked is about the how technology and innovation can help to build up efficient rapid diagnostics.
Yeah.
So I think rapid diagnostics is definitely the going future, and history has shown us limitations can actually drive innovation, and today that will happen. Healthcare providers must learn to incorporate new technology for diagnosis. The simple reason that vaccination, drug treatment, and other containment efforts cannot be maximized unless emerging diseases are quickly identified. And that's where the rapid testing has come up into a very important thing. The rapid testing advantages, challenges, we will not lie down to discuss here. This is not the platform, but there are big advantages. They are low cost, simple to operate, sensitive. Specificity is definitely have to be taken into account. Stable high temperature, on-site screening, within the clinic, because if you diagnose something after 72 hours and the patient is, then probably the purpose is defeated. We need to do the testing as early as possible, as close to as individual, near patient or a point of care testing is very, very important. The new technologies what we're using today are now, they've been using for a past for lateral flow test, something like a CAR test, then we have agglutination test, then you have a dipstick test for urine, which we normally use. But now, lab on chip has come up. Microfluid, lab on chip, where more information, simple lab on chip, one drop, and multiple type of samples. Probably it's a saliva sample or a body fluid sample, your urine sample, can give you more information by utilizing this technology. Then the last important part is the conventional versus rapid molecular, because conventional is always culture. You got a culture comes in 42 hours, 72 hours, and then even 5 days or 7 days or 3 weeks. But today, it is a rapid PCR, which has changed the scenario. I think molecular, point of care molecular, we can easily get reports from in 2 hours to 8 hours, 10 hours, depending on the kind of test. So this is, I think these are the important technologies which is going to be a very, very use for future. They are being used in all aspects, probably. There's going to be much, much, much bigger use in future and going to come up in the practice. I'll sum up with this, that, you know, a talent for following the ways of yesterday are not sufficient to improve the world of today. These are much more apt today. Understanding what is driving change, the first step being able to prepare for it. Trying to slow down or stop that challenge is an illusion. Change has to happen. We have to adopt new practices. New roads and paths have to be developed. How they evolve, how they develop, and the change will shape the world of future for the good and the bad. That is what I would say.
Thank you. I think great words of wisdom coming from Dr. Gaur. I have two simple questions from Thomas John. One is that Agape, as we know, is a leading IVD manufacturer. Did you feel any economic impact on the business? That is the question number one. And second is, do you suggest any regulatory framework changes by the government? These are the two questions. Please answer.
Yeah, I come to the answer for the first question. In the initial days of the lockdown or pandemic, it's a really affected to us. Maybe March, you know, even though it was the last month of the last financial year, we lost about 20% of the business. But we, two of our main focus really helped us to overcome all these things, which we have taken last 5 years. Last 5 years, Agape is focusing about 5% of minimum 5 to 6% of our revenue for R&D. We have about 100 people working in different technologies, and we are bringing different technologies to India. That is one thing. So quickly, we were able to bring some of the products which we were working for last couple of years. Second biggest advantage, we understood that the need of infrastructure. India is such a big country where 60 to 70,000 of laboratories, where about 5,000 village and mini metros. So we have about 5 branches with about 1,000 distributors and 350 sales and service people. They could easily able to manage, local staff able to manage 16 to 17,000 customers, those who are using about 25,000 different equipments of Agape. So initial period, we had some problem because of the complete lockdown. And after that, because we had that local staff, local solutions, we were able to manage, and our sales and service staff done a very great job, where, you know, okay, we could able to give a good service and good support to our customers. Coming to the second question, of course, this is very, you know, I would say that how can I openly answer that? But the government should be a little more proactive, and they should give preferences to the domestic manufacturers. In the past, there was a feeling that domestic manufacturers always they bring, because we are Indian, so we bring, you know, little reduced quality. It's not like that. Today, the COVID taught to everybody the importance of the domestic. So they should give some importance to the you know, local manufacturers. It's not like I'm from Kerala and little socialistic approach. I'm telling you the fact. Second, they should open a lot of IVD parks in India, because in vitro diagnostics is one area, or medical device as a whole is one of the area where there can be a tremendous opportunity in India. Then they should be open to address with different manufacturers and give the open feedback. And if I will be little jealous or a little greedy, I can say that some import exemptions, like customs duty exemptions to the those who are locally manufacturing. So these are the some of the broad feeling from my side where government can give support. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Gani.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And now I come to Hasmukh Rawal, because you hold the very unique position of indigenous manufacturer of the molecular diagnostics tests. I think that we should be proud of it, you know. And so actually we want to see that how you make it global now. And secondly, how do we promote the investor to the molecular diagnostic sector in India? These are the two parts. Please answer.
Definitely, sir. We have, as soon as we started manufacturing, our vision was always global. The basic foundation of starting MyLab was also to go global and make the solutions affordable to all. Luckily, with the COVID situation, the attraction towards healthcare have been increased in a big way. A lot of investors who are looking at this space, and they can see the scale. So just to give you an idea, we also had a difficult time in educating investors that what is the scale of high-end test brought at a price can bring. But yes, luckily today, there's a lot of attraction toward investment. But what I see is the investment should not only in the company, it should be also in the IP. And then unless we don't develop our own IP, no matter what product line we want to enter, we will never be able to succeed. So to go global or go at international level, maintaining the quality is of course of most importance, but also having your own IP is going to be the longer run goal. Any companies focusing on this will be very important, will have a good opportunities over a period. Even government should look into, so we have a good brains and so in academia, a lot of innovative people, but the public-private partnership with these kind of people, looking at a product-oriented goal is very important, and I think there we focus.
Okay, so we are still having a lot of hope, you know, that you will make India proud through your innovative products.
I assure you there will be not many innovative products coming over next years and years to come. And our focus is to make it simpler, affordable and cost-effective to all.
Very nice. So my last panelist is Dr. Arjun Dan. And as I told that your lab was the first to go for ISO 9001, then to the NABL. So my question is how you are going to balance the quality versus the cost. You have to maintain the quality and still deliver at the cost, because you will be always under pressure to deliver the testing diagnostic at the lower cost. Please tell us your strategy.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for that question. And actually, this is something that all of us have been wondering about, and most of the people in the diagnostics market have experienced this as well. the patient flow, like what Dr. Ravi sir also said, was that it shrunk to the minimum that we've probably seen in the past 2 years in the months of April, May and June. But then after that, once the lockdown opened up, patients did actually start coming in. Even with the patient flow at the bare minimum in these months, what was actually required was a lot of training and also, more importantly, a lot of innovation. So this innovation that led to labs going out on more technology-based platforms, for example, the drive-through services also that we started and many other labs have it now, was a need of the hour. So it is basically coming up with a model or an idea that suits the patients, that makes them feel more safe, where there is minimum interaction and minimum exposure to the outside environment. So for example, in a drive-through, we had initially started the drive-through as a novel initiative just for COVID PCR tests. But now I see that the demand has increased to such a level that people, even if they're coming for a regular blood test, they always request to get a slot in the drive-through only, because they have more peace of mind when they're sitting inside the comfort of their car, etc. So definitely the patient reduced, but it led to a requirement of changing the way we do things altogether. The second one was also, since the regular walk-in patients had reduced significantly, our lab took the major leap of entering into the spectrum of clinical trials, and we were very happy to be selected as the central lab for a COVID vaccine, also co-vaccine that's being developed. So again, it was a time to innovate, diversify, and at least keep the lab sustained at a level where all our staff is motivated and at the same time also busy throughout. Again, so coming to the second question, this is something that I look at it in a way that cost and quality are both opposite ends of a seesaw. But also, I've also read this, that value is always quality divided by cost. So if you want to increase value to your patients, you increase quality and you reduce the cost. But then again, we are sitting in a place where to actually make cost and quality come midway and give a very high quality service to the patient at a very low cost is definitely the need of the hour. And to sum it up, in a nutshell, what I feel is that this can happen if we manage to make our processes, our entire process in the lab, seamless and reach a level where it is completely patient-oriented. So what I mean by that is that training is key. So when we talk about a sample, it shouldn't just be a sample that we are running in the lab, but a sample or a simple vacutainer actually represents a real human being. So actually to sensitize the staff in the lab, the importance of just a sample there and how to process it from the pre-analytical phase to the post-analytical phase, maybe your front office, your customer care, your doctors, your team of technicians in the lab or your home collection suite. At every point, we need to brainstorm how to increase value and also give the absolute best to all our patients. Thank you, sir.
Very good answer coming from a young doctor. I think I'm very happy. You see, only thing is I want to tell you that quality is not to be compromised. Whatever happens, because quality is related to the patient safety. Only thing is, how can you reduce the cost is basically by improving the efficiency using technology, with Dr. Ravi God and Hashmukh were telling, you know, that you have to use technology to improve the efficiency, but never ever compromise on the quality in the diagnostic, because that is the hallmark. So I think I will only say, I think this has been the fantastic inputs coming from the four of you. And I think these inputs are very important to take our diagnostic industry to the level 2 now. And we are now poised, government also is now very serious. This Atmanirbhar Bharat and the demand on the healthcare are going to join together. And we will have a lot of opportunity to innovate and intervene. And there is no question of any, you know, financial unsustainability, because so much scope is there to expand. We are not gone into tier 3 markets, cities. We are not gone to rural cities. So once we have got more resources trained, I think that is where the constraint is coming. Doctors are not there. Forget doctors, even healthcare workers are not there. We are not being able to create the allied healthcare, you know, commission, you know, which has been pending in the parliament. There is an NMC now has been announced only yesterday. Now the nursing council also needs a bit of revamping, and allied healthcare workforce also has to be brought. Once that comes into picture, I think India has got so much potential in terms of manpower. As I said, not only we will meet our own needs, maybe in next 5 years we will be able to supply the manpower, technology and services to the overseas market. So I think we have to look up now, and fantastic work is being done by the diagnostic, and bit of regulatory, I think, interventions are required, which will be hopefully coming. And with that, I thought let us close, because we wanted to close at 1:50. And thank you once again. Thank you very much. We'll see you again.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everybody.